This sermon was preached at First Evangelical Lutheran Church in North Platte, Nebraska. I'm Pastor Arnold Flader, the preacher. This sermon took place on the second Sunday in Advent in 2019. The passage that was the theme of the sermon came from Paul's letter in 1 Corinthians chapter 2. When I come to you, brothers and sisters, I did not come proclaiming the mystery of God to you in lofty words and wisdom, for I decided to know nothing among you except Jesus Christ and Him crucified. And I came to you in weakness and in fear and in much trembling. Beloved in Christ, grace and peace to you from God our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ, the one who is the joy of every longing heart. Let us pray. Amen. Respect for the mystery. The lack of mystery in our modern life is our downfall and our poverty. A human life is worth as much as the respect it holds for the mystery. We retain the child in us to the extent that we honor the mystery. Therefore, children have open, wide-awake eyes because they know that they are surrounded by the mystery. They are not yet finished with this world. They still don't know how to struggle along and avoid the mystery as we do. We destroy the mystery because we sense that here we reach the boundary of our being, because we want to be Lord over everything and have it at our disposal. And that's just what we cannot do with the mystery. These words were written by the Lutheran pastor, theologian, and yes, martyr, Dietrich Bonhoeffer. They come from a collection of his Advent writings titled God is in the Manger. The words you just heard, I understand, came from Pastor Bonhoeffer while he was incarcerated in a Nazi prison during World War II. The Reverend Dietrich Bonhoeffer was a pacifist who was led by the words of Christ in Scripture to leave behind self and one's own idea of a secure life, to bring to an end the life of a heinous and catastrophic ruler by the name of Adolf Hitler. Bonhoeffer was executed just days before the Allied liberation of Germany. This April of 2020 marks the 75th anniversary of his death. Today's quote about mystery in children is a centerpiece of my ministry in helping the congregations I serve to understand how all of Christian fellowship and learning must happen with the generations together in one place at the same time. You as a congregation, for the most part, misunderstand the gift of children and why we would gather with them in their learning, and has happened twice this past week, in their presentations of the gospel of Jesus. On Thursday and Friday of this week, a children's Christmas program was held in this building. Our preschool presented those programs. Those gathered were there to see cute children and special grandchildren do their thing. Now, don't get me wrong. I am a grandpa, and I love doing just that. But as Christians, we so often have it all wrong. All too often, I've heard older Christians say things like, "Well, I'm not helping with that children's event. I've done my time." Or something like, well, why would I go to that? I don't have kids in it. As Pastor Bonhoeffer insists, young children almost always exhibit a presence of the mystery of God in Christ. You see, when you fail to sit with them in things like what I've asked from vacation Bible school, and as I invited last Sunday in their preschool programs, you exhibit your own absence, your own loss of the mystery. It's in the failing of most adults, we, as Bonhoeffer said, destroy the mystery because we sense that here in this world, we reach the boundary of our being because we want to be Lord over everything. I'm sorry that you haven't yet heard my invitation of this gift of mystery. Would you do something for me, please? As I've asked a couple times now already, would you buy this book? Would you buy God is in the Manger? And when you get it, would you open it to page for the week 2, day 1, entitled Respect the Mystery? Open it to the quote that I read just a couple moments ago. Would you lay it on the mantle or on the kitchen table or at your bed table or someplace where the truth will sink in? Your life in Christ, as well as the future of the congregation you love so much, depends on this simple truth. We gather with children, not because we must teach them something. We gather with them so they might share with us the mystery of Christ that's with them and with us. So intergenerational gathering is an essential experience for restoration of that kind of the mystery of Christ. Healthy, thriving congregations get that. When congregations get that, the volunteers are many, and commitment by adults is no longer seen as an obligation, but as a gift. Today, then, I want to share more about the life of Pastor Bonhoeffer in a clip from the teaching of this man. Professor Tom Griggs holds the Marshall Chair of Divinity seat at the University of Aberdeen. That's one of the oldest divinity chairs established in the world. It came to be in 1616. And he's the founding co-director of the Aberdeen Center for Protestant Theology. And so now he serves as head of divinity at the University of Aberdeen King's College in Scotland. Professor Griggs, speaking of Dietrich Bonhoeffer.
I guess it's quite rare, really, that you find, as a theologian, someone whose life is as exciting as their theology. And when it comes to Bonhoeffer, what we see is someone who lives through the climactic events of the 20th century and who does theology within that context and also theology about that context. As an individual, I guess I was particularly interested in the way that Bonhoeffer thought about the conditions of post-Christendom, the situation that the church found itself in of being weak, a situation where secularism had run rife. And rather than simply capitulating ground as a theologian to secularism or hurling grenades as a fundamentalist or something, Bonhoeffer actually thinks theologically about a situation in which he finds himself and declares not simply that the world has come of age in secularism, but that the world has come of age in Jesus Christ. As a younger man, I found that idea absolutely captivating. And his devotional works on discipleship as well, I found it utterly thrilling and enthralling. The idea of a theologian who was deeply interested in a life of faith and a life of commitment, a theologian who in the end would pay the ultimate price for that life of faith and that life of commitment to Jesus Christ. Bonhoeffer wasn't born into a particularly religious family, interestingly. His mother did nurture the faith of their children and they were all baptized. But his father thought it was a very strange decision for him to be a theologian. And his brothers and his father, in fact, teased him about it and tried to discourage him from it when at 14 Bonhoeffer announced that he was going to be a theologian. They explained that this was an outmoded and outdated institution, and Bonhoeffer bravely and boldly said that he was going to change it then. And I suspect he has done in terms of the reception of his theology. During his time in Berlin, there was the rise of the Nazi Party that took place, and I guess much of Bonhoeffer's subsequent life is thought about in terms of that context. Bonhoeffer was prophetic in his recognition of the dangers of the concept of the Führer and the dangers of Adolf Hitler. And even before Hitler was announced as Reichschancellor in 1933, Bonhoeffer was being broadcast on the dangers of the Führer concept for young Germans. Bonhoeffer already recognized some of the dangers that took place. And I guess it's that aspect of his life that more than anything he's remembered for. He spent his remaining time variously engaged in opposing Hitler and Hitler's regime. Interestingly, he seems to have followed his grandmother's followed in his grandmother's shoes with regard to that. His grandmother was a woman who knew her own mind, and despite being 90, barged past stormtroopers to go and shop in the Jewish shop where she'd always shopped, and these befuddled men carrying machine guns, looked at her and she said, "I will do my shopping where I always do my shopping." Bonhoeffer seems to have got a degree of that sort of bravery from his grandmother, and indeed was very outspoken about the circumstances and situations that the Jewish people found themselves in the 1930s in Germany. Famously said, "Only he who shouts for the Jews can sing the Gregorian chants."
On day three of this week, in the book God is in the Manger, in the Mystery of Christ week, Pastor Bonhoeffer wrote, "The wonder of all wonders is that God travels wonderful ways with human beings, but he does not comply with the views and opinions of people. God does not go the way that people want to prescribe him. Rather, his way is beyond all comprehension, free and self-determined, beyond all proof." The mystery of Christ is that God does travel with us in all things. Such is the path of pastoral care. In it, God travels with you. As a Lutheran pastor, being with folks in their lives, especially during times of challenge, is always a gift. As in this week, as we saw both Bob and Arlene leave the hospital and continue that long path of healing, a great moment of pastoral care, especially after wondering if we'd ever talk again with Arlene after a challenging week. And on Monday, as the word came that member Don Lundquist had died, after caring for him in the past months, I also had the privilege this week, the rewarding gift of walking with the family as we buried him on Friday. It has been a busy week. For me personally, it will always be a memorable week. On Monday, my spouse Julie and I sat waiting in an examination room at Great Plains Health, hoping for a different word when my doctor came in and sat down as she announced the diagnosis. "You have cancer," she said. As quickly as she said that, I also heard that my prognosis is very good, but surgery will be needed to remove those cells that seek to kill as they multiply. A surgeon will cut them out. "Yes, I have cancer in my body, but the prognosis is very good. All this means that I will need several weeks of recovery after the surgery. After having just scolded you about hanging out with the kids, I have the audacity to ask for your help. I need your prayers for healing and well-being. I need your ability to volunteer and to care for each other and for me to grow even more. First and foremost, I tell you this now because I need your prayers now. Please, daily. I know you're up for the job. I do. On Friday night, in the midst of a long walk, I spoke with my best friend Chuck and told him all about this and what I would need. He said, 'Arnold, this will be a good thing for your congregation, if what you say about them is true.' It's true, isn't it? You have that gift of the mystery of Christ present in you, with and under you. You will be blessed in this process." I was reminded this week that my perfect record has been broken. Yeah, that's right. You see, in 25 years of ministry, I've never really missed a single day of work due to illness. That ended actually on November 22nd this year when I had my biopsy. It's probably time for me to give that up, right? Pastor Bonhoeffer says we all need at times, as I do, to forget that we are Lord over everything, because we're not. The book God is in the Manger has been a mainstay of mine for many years. This year, I'm hearing things in new ways. Again, Dietrich Bonhoeffer wrote, "Who among us will celebrate Christmas correctly? Whoever finally lays down all power, all honor, all reputation, all vanity, all arrogance, all individualism beside the manger. Whoever remains lowly and lets God alone be high. Whoever looks at the child in the manger and sees the glory of God precisely in his lowliness." Allow the gifts of Christian singer Sarah Groves and the hymn of Charles Wesley once again invite us in prayer to the mystery of Christ.
Come, thou long expected Jesus, born to set thy people free from our fears and sins, release us. Let us find our rest in thee. Israel's strength and consolation, hope of all the earth thou art. Dear desire of every nation, joy of every longing heart.
He is the joy of every longing heart. Amen.